Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My sisters and brothers, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Reading from the Book of Wisdom. Who can know God's counsel? Or who can conceive what the Lord intends? For the deliberations of mortals are timid, and unsure are our plans. For the corruptible body burdens the soul, and the earthen shelter weighs down the mind that has many concerns. And scarce do we guess the things on earth, and what is within our grasp we find with difficulty. But when things are in heaven, who can search them out? Or, whoever knew your counsel, except you had given wisdom and sent your Holy Spirit from on high. And thus were the paths of those on earth made straight. The word of the Lord.
Amen.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philemons. I, Paul, an old man, and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, urge you on behalf of my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become in my imprisonment. I am sending him, that is my own heart, back to you. I should have liked to retain him for myself, so that he might serve me on your behalf. In my imprisonment for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that the good you do might not be forced, but voluntary. Perhaps this is why he was away from you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a brother, beloved especially to me. of man and in the Lord. So if you regard me as a partner, welcome him as you would me. The word of the Lord.
Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Which of you wishing to construct a tower does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if there is enough for its completion? Otherwise, after laying the foundation and finding himself unable to finish the work, the onlookers would laugh at him and say, "This one began to build, but did not have the resources to finish." For what king marching into battle would not first sit down and decide whether with 10,000 troops he can successfully oppose another king, advancing upon him with 20,000 troops? But if not, while he is still far away, he will send a delegation to ask for peace terms. In the same way, any one of you who does not renounce all his possessions cannot be my disciple. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus
Christ. My Aunt Billy was a British war bride. Her father and brothers were killed in battle in World War II. Her mother and sisters were killed in the Blitz of London, and she was spared. She was a nurse, and so she was out in the countryside at nursing homes, taking care of those soldiers coming back from the continent. And that's how she met my uncle. But growing up in Indiana, we always loved going to Aunt Billy and Uncle Joe's house because, unlike all the pictures in our own house, in the living room, in pride of place, was a picture of Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip and Winston Churchill. And that was so exotic to us. Who are these people? And so she would tell us many stories of her upbringing. And she told a story, and I've heard it elsewhere too, about Winston Churchill. He was magnanimous. He was a statesman in many ways, but he also could be very mean and petty in other ways. And so he would sometimes have feuds with people. And there was one with somebody in another party than he was. And they had a long history of being against each other. Lady Astor would get frustrated with him, he would get frustrated with Lady Astor. And so at one time in the House of Lords, she got so frustrated with Winston Churchill that she said, "Winston, if you were my husband, I would poison your tea." And very placidly, Winston Churchill looked at her and said, "Lady Astor, if you were my wife, I would drink it." And so we hear today about hate. We hear about challenging relationships. We hear about picking up our crosses. Through life or dying to ourselves, we will achieve the life that we are called to have. And then we hear through the cross, which we often don't want to hear anything about. That is how we receive our crown of glory. So in the gospel, we hear the words and we see the situations that will often shock us in our modern sensibilities. What? We hear we must hate? We must hate our mother and father and brothers and sisters and children and even our own lives? And so the word hate coming out of the mouth of Jesus seems wrong. It goes against every picture we have had of him, every movie that we've seen of him. And so we often then will shy away from the rest of the message of what he's trying to really give you, the point that he's really trying to make in these readings. We can easily dismiss Jesus if we stop listening after we hear what seems unconscionable. How can we hate? Because there's so many messages and lessons elsewhere in the gospel that tells us how we are called to love, especially those who are close to us. And so Jesus tells his would-be disciples that they must hate the nearest and dearest in their world in order to be true disciples. But he's not asking them to do that literally. Instead, he's just trying to get them to recalibrate, see things as he sees it, that he doesn't want a disintegration of family life. Instead, he who is the Prince of Peace, the Prince of Love, is just trying to get them to see things in a different way. That this message is not going to be easy. This path is not going to be easy for them. Because in many ways, they think of him as the earthly Messiah, the one who will kick out the Romans, kick out the Roman conquest. And so Jesus in the gospel states that loyalty to him will come sometime with a sacrifice. There will be a cost, that Christian cost of discipleship. Jesus is telling us in his last few weeks that where he is headed. He tells, he's very clear, and his disciples don't want to hear anything about it. I'm on my way to Jerusalem. I picked up my cross, and I want you to do the same. I want you to follow me, so you too can follow me on the road to salvation. And so Jesus is once again making sure that his disciples understand exactly what it means to carry a cross, what it means to imitate him, and to be in solidarity with him. So he's telling them, as he tells us, carry your cross, whatever it may be, in union with me, and I will help you carry it. My burden is light. My yoke is easy. And so the burdens are more than the physical cross. It is an instrument. It is a tool. It is an image of that Christian identity of grace and even of glory. Another situation with Winston Churchill. On becoming Prime Minister, with the clouds of war on the European horizon, Winston said about his dedication to their cause, I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, sweat, and tears. So Jesus basically says the same thing in the readings today. He turns to all the great crowds that have been following him, who have been getting something from him without any cost. And so he's telling them, with these gifts come also responsibility. It will be a cross, and you must follow me to be my true disciples. And so Winston Churchill did not only offer his people his blood, toil, sweat, and tears, but he also offered them a hope of victory. And that's what Jesus also does to his disciples and those who are following. Jesus invites his disciples to carry their cross with purpose, but always carrying that cross of hope. So today, the question comes to us. What is the cross that Jesus is inviting you to pick up? What cross is he asking you to carry to Jerusalem? How are you able to carry a cross to Calvary? So just like the feud with Lady Astor and Winston Churchill, our crosses can be petty. The ordinary, the common burdens of life, the cross of injustice, the cross of illness and the lack of health, the cross of AIDS and cancer and heart disease, and asthma, and COVID, the cross of poverty, the cross of going throughout life without a parent who raised you, or a spouse that you married who is no longer a part of the picture, or a child that you loved, and all those relationships can be broken either due to separation or death. The cross can also be regional. The cross carried under oppressive societies, or cross carried under stunting realities. struggling in troubled neighborhoods where crime and gang and violence and drugs have taken root. They can wear people down, and those are the crosses they are called to pick up as they attempt to resist and dislodge those things that tear them down on a daily basis. And a cross can be our own particular crosses, a cross of a particular weakness or a particular disposition, a judging spirit, a quick temper, a sarcastic word. But then it can also be our own failings in whatever way that is, that monkey that's on our own back. Things that lead us into dangerous situations or make us antisocial. Addiction to the internet, to drugs, to alcohol, to pornography, to domestic violence. The struggle to be free of such a cross can often be difficult. But we have examples in many aspects of our lives. We see it in the lives of the saints, but one more close to us, Mother Teresa, St. Teresa of Calcutta, she carried a cross. And we often forget about that as part of her life. We see of all the things that she did, being called out of a teaching ministry, going into Calcutta, and picking up those in the gutter, those that the society had said were not worth saving. She had at one moment, she had that clarity of God being with her as she then went to India. But then for 50 years, as she continued to do the work that we have known, that made her famous, that gave her many accolades throughout the world, she was in 50 years of darkness. She never had that closeness with God again. And that was her cross. And so we often have those kind of crosses. We've been raised in our church. We've been raised in our faith. But sometimes it doesn't feel like God is part of our lives. We're doing everything on the outside, but inward, we don't seem to have a connection. And so we pray to Mother Teresa in those situations. We pray to Jesus. We pray for the saints to help us to pick up our cross in those situations where we don't always know what the answer is, where the path is not always lit, where we sometimes question, what's the point of even praying? Because we can often treat God as a vending machine God. We say our prayers and we expect our answers right away. But we're often reminded that our cross might last us 50 years. Just like St. Monica did, as she prayed for her son. She prayed for him for over 30 years before he came to the faith. And so, do we have that kind of perseverance? Do we have that kind of courageousness? Do we have that kind of perseverance that we are called to have? And so Jesus shows us an example of Mother Teresa, that hope of victory. She never lost hope in all those times. As she went with spiritual directors, she was honest with what was going on in her life. She didn't get the results that we would want automatically to happen with her. But she was out there in the streets daily, living out the gospel message of love to those that the people had, the societies had cast out. And so we are called and reminded that Jesus promises us that by carrying our cross, we will also receive our crown. That purpose will bring us to that greater glory that God promises us. So let us remember, in Christ, there is no crown without the cross. But also then goes the other way. Let us pick up our cross and recognize through that cross, that's how we receive our crown. So that's our challenge, as we recognize the crosses in our lives that we are called to pick up and carry onward. That we pick up the cross. And let us pick it up knowing that we are heading to our crown.
Thank you.
church, that all Christians may courageously embrace the cross and enter the Paschal mystery, laying aside selfishness and rising to a life of love and service. Let us pray to the Lord. For the renewal of creativity, that the Spirit of God will inspire us to use the many gifts that God has given us to bring forth new blessings and undreamed of possibilities for our faith, community, and all the human family. Let us pray to the Lord. For preservation of our common home, that God will inspire leaders to develop policies and practices that will preserve the natural systems that God designed for the earth so that all may benefit from earth's resources. Let us pray to the Lord. For the gift of wisdom, that the Holy Spirit will enlighten us with insight and understanding, so we may follow Jesus in his way of love and mercy within our families and our community. Let us pray to the Lord. For those who are sick, that they may be restored to health in mind and body, we pray especially for Mary and Santer, Mona Traub, Richard Traub, Anne Bianchi, Baby Benjamin Pirog, Dolores Peters, Salvatore Gigliardi, and Mary Wysak. Let us pray to the Lord. For the souls in purgatory and those who have died, that they may inherit the reward of heaven awaiting them. We pray for all the deceased, especially for Dorothy Considine. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord Jesus, hear our prayers for the needs of all people. Send your Son to us that we might become a people who walk in the light, a people who seek your presence and joy in all things. We make our prayer in Jesus' name, both now and forever.
And as the gifts are brought forth, let us all sing, "I Has Not Seen," number 297.
Oh,
may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, you may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and just.
It is good and just, for to the end of our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. For Holy Father, Almighty, eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his mercy, Christ renewed all humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering, canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life. And by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, and without it we acclaim. You're indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. With your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and bring them to being. And you never cease to gather people to yourself. So that from the rising of the sun to the setting of your sacrifice may be offered in your name. Therefore, O Lord, we come before you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we brought to you. On the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and gave you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take all of you and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." All of you and drink from it, but this is the chalice of my blood. The blood is a new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Thanksgiving is holy and living sacrifice. But we pray, Amen. pleased to confer on the name of charity, your personal maturity on earth, with your servant, Francis R. Cole, and the ladies of our bishop, the older bishops, all of the clergy, and all the people who gain for your own. Listen graciously to the prayer of the Christian, whom you have summoned before you in the past by the word of the Father, gathered to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, for the part of brothers and sisters, to all who are pleasing to the capacity in this life, give time and ministry to them, that we hope and enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, for Christ our Lord, who has bestowed on the world all that is good. Peace in you. Let us pray. Grant that your faithful, O Lord, will be nourished and endowed with life through the food of your word and heavenly sacrament, may so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit the eternal share in his life, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Before we go, I know at the very beginning we also said when they announced that today's her last official Mass. We know she can't get away that easy. She'll be back for different things. So we wanted to show a round of appreciation once again for 33 years?
33 years, but 54 in the Archdiocese.
54 in the Archdiocese, 33. Thank you. Thank you. We know Jesus only made it to 33 himself, so she's getting out ahead. But I just want to say thank you from Father Bill and Father John and to all the pastors and associates who've been here before and all the people who come, common witnesses that are with us even today, that you've been able to bless in so many ways for your ministry, not only here but elsewhere. And knowing that we'll be just as busy, because I hear retired people are more busy than they ever were, especially as she starts having more family to attend to. But she's looking to travel well. So we want to continue to keep her in our prayers. We want to make sure that she travels well with her husband. Or they can be accepted if necessary. So we just have a blessing. So again, let's show a round of appreciation. We are having an actual official final Mass, celebration Mass on
October 9th.
On October 9th.
At 11:30.
Please just put that in your calendar. So we've been blessed with so many ways here. For all these many years. I knew her by reputation, a good reputation at that, because her sister was music director at St. Emmerich, where I was from originally. So I always feel like